Welcome, Collider fans, to the Game of Thrones recap and review show. I'm John Rocha. Season 6, Episode 10, The Winds of Winter. Season finale for Season 6. So much going on. I'm going to go ahead and say it right off the bat. I absolutely love this episode as much as I love last week's episode, but for different reasons. Last week's was all about, this week's is all political machinations and a lot of stuff going on with the Mind, which I really enjoyed. But before we get into all the stuff we got to get into, including Dorne making an appearance, hello, let's introduce everybody around the table, all the way to my far left.
Yeah, we got a packed panel today. Yeah, this episode and last episode together are two of the best episodes of television that we've ever seen.
And then to my immediate left.
Hey guys, I'm so happy that I'm back. I was really bummed, obviously, that I missed last week, but I gotta say, it's okay. I think I got what I was waiting for, so I'm fine.
Well, we did miss you, Perry. And
my immediate right, rather.
I am Avi Talash, and I'm so happy that Perry's back this week. Thank God.
She doesn't want to hang out with the boys.
And to my far right.
Yeah, man, we finally made it to the end. We finally made it to the end of season 6, and what a great season, honestly.
Yeah.
Regardless of all the hubbub about it not being supported by a book that's out yet, one of my favorite seasons.
Yeah, I wonder if we can make that argument that maybe we don't need the books anymore. Like, at this point, they did such a great job with some of the references, but they were able to do really great work with the storylines all through the season. And at some point, it becomes a TV show, just a TV show, you know? And I wonder if that's essentially what may happen in season 7, if they're going to jump that far ahead, depending on what comes out with the next book from George R. R. Martin. But anyway, let's get going. Let's start at King's Landing, where it was an explosion. We saw the appearance of the Wildfire. We had so much going on. We had massive deaths. Dennis, can just start us off because there's so much to cover here. Well, what did you think
about this King's Landing sequence? The opening sequence is about 20 minutes long.
Yeah.
And it's absolutely fantastic. One of the best opening sequences we've seen, like, not just on Game of Thrones, but on television. Yeah. It opens up and it starts with that music, which, you know, we've heard music before in Game of Thrones, but this was a little different. The piano and with violin, some choral sounds to it as well. The way that it's put together and just seeing, you know, you see Cersei and you're wondering, why is she getting so dressed up for this trial? You know, she puts on that like giant ring, she's wearing all black and the necklace, and seeing what happens, you know, in the great Sept of Baelor. Yeah. And seeing characters that, you know, some that you kind of knew that were going to kick the bucket, like Loras. I mean, he was cast as Dany Rand in Iron Fist. We knew he was gone. Marjorie, that was unexpected for me.
Very unexpected.
We got to see. There was a lot of predictions about the Wildfire and Cersei, but I guess it was contained in that one area.
Yeah, it was fascinating because the High Sparrow just poof, that's it.
Yeah,
there was no real lead up. There was no like torture or anything. He's just boom and he's gone, and we just have to accept. And the entire, like, everybody just wiped out. Mace Tyrell, everybody, you know, which leads us in a little bit to what happens in Dorne. What did you think about the sequence, Perry?
This might be one of my favorite sequences the entire series. This was just so well done, in large part thanks to the music that you brought up, just the way, because most of the time with Game of Thrones, you're used to, you know, horns and drums and battle sounds, and this had such like an ominous feel to it. And then when it would disappear, it would kind of like suck the air out of the room. Like when Loras was going through his trial, it was so tense and scary because all of a sudden that kind of faded away. And then it would come back. But Cersei's look was incredible. I kept looking at her thinking she was like a Disney villain. Clearly she was up to something, but I mean, there's so many things to pinpoint that the way Tommen goes out, that shot, and the second it's holding on the building, burning in the background, you just know something's bad. Something bad is coming. And I just love the fact that this is what started the episode too, because not that the episode fizzled out by any means as it went along, but I feel like if this was in the end, it would have done a disservice to everything else that followed it. So I'm so happy they structured it this way.
Yeah, that's a great point you bring up, because I think we were kind of brought into this mood from the beginning of the show, even from previously on Game of Thrones. We saw no dialogue. It was all images and sounds and cut together, obviously. And then the whole episode begins with almost no talking until that attendant comes in and says it's time to go. Until that, you hear the sounds of just the music, like you said, and these real dignified shots of everybody getting ready. You know, it was fantastic, which leads you into, I mean, it's almost like they were washing themselves or prepping themselves for death, like for their own funerals, which was fascinating stuff to watch. Avital, what did you think?
I mean, I loved the episode as well. To Dennis's point, I think score was used so well in this episode, but there were moments that I actually found it distracting, not in the beginning, but there were areas where I could have done without some of it. The scene of Tommen jumping, that one, you didn't care. Dennis was ready for him to die. That really got me.
I was probably clapping. I was like, yes.
I think you did clap.
Probably.
That got me more.
There's a couple of woos too, yeah.
I think more than any other, weirdly, any other moment in that, in this episode, that just like broke my heart for whatever reason. And it also, very interestingly, I've had a lot of empathy for Cersei, even though she's been a bad guy pretty consistently. Right. Now I don't. Now I'm just like ready for her to be gone. I mean, not because she's a great villain. But yeah, it was really compelling. I thought it was very interesting that the High Sparrow lies to Margaery, that he promised her something that he didn't deliver, because he seems to have, up until then, at least adhered to his own sort of morality, his sense of morality. Like he, you know, that was just, it seemed almost like that was punishment for him being misleading. I was surprised. I thought that this whole time Margaery had more up her sleeve than just we'll kowtow to these people and then we'll eventually persevere. It seemed like she was up to something more than just letting the High Sparrow win for now. But clearly she wasn't, you know? She saw too late what was happening. But
it's a quintessential Game of Thrones moment where we think something is being led up to something else and then the left turn happens. It zigs when it's supposed to zag. Everybody just gets blown up instead of, I'm sure she had her political machinations. She was working on Tom and she had her things. I mean, the fact that she spoke to the Sparrow, she really revealed herself when she said, enough of that stuff. You know, we're about to die. Yeah. Let's get going. You know, she broke all protocol that she had been fake pretending to be. And in that moment, you saw there, she had other things going on that she was putting in motion. I think one of the greatest things she ever did was sending Lady Tyrell out of the city, luckily, in that moment. But yeah, so much going
on
there.
Which shows us that there are big plans, I think, for Lady Tyrell. That's no accident that they made a moment of her leaving and seeing her. We'll get to the Dorne stuff. But
so unfortunate, though, because I was such a huge fan of Natalie Dormer. So
yeah, she's great on the show. Right? But it just shows you that even though, you know, she's smart and she can be manipulative, she's not on the level of a Cersei.
Yep.
You know, Cersei's on that level. And another thing is Cersei fills the void now, because we talked about Ramsay's dead. Like all these other, High Sparrow now is dead. Right. Who's going to fill that place of that villain?
Yeah.
Cersei, yes, has been, she's not a good character, but there's been moments where you could empathize with her. Now she's gone full villain.
Absolutely. I think what Avital said is perfect. Like the fact that that, you know, we had feelings. I was saying on the show for a couple of weeks now, I'm starting to feel the sympathy for Cersei, and then boom, no more. Jonathan, please jump in. What did you think about this? What do you want to talk about?
I thought it was great. Last week, I figured, okay, this city's going down in wildfire. I was under the understanding, just the way I was reading into it, that she was burning the whole city.
Right.
I thought she was gonna, like, we were talking tens of thousands of people dead. This was pretty Godfather gangster to do this one strike that took out all of her enemies in the city. It did spare the city. I mean, a lot of people, other people died, though. We saw that one guy get smashed by a bell.
By the bell.
And whatever, but very calculating, but at the same time, you know what? Man, she paid for it, and she lost another son.
Yeah. What did you think about Tommen's suicide?
It was probably the most decisive decision he's made on his own.
Absolutely. Felt the same way.
And I thought it was a beautiful scene. You know, I'm sitting here watching Game of Thrones, and I'm thinking, okay, if you're showing me an open window and you're holding on it, something's coming through that window, or something's going out that window. And when I heard him, you hear in the background the sound of him putting down the crown, but you don't see it. Yeah. And I start hearing his steps come back. I'm like, he's jumping out.
Yeah.
Yep, there he goes.
Yeah.
It was great.
I was so shocked. I didn't anticipate that, because I thought he's still a young kid. He's still figuring it out. And so I think, like they said, he was a young, impressionable child. He just got twisted into one too many knots, and the only resolution was jumping out that window.
I think he, you know, was a real sweetheart, and he was in love. And it may have been his one and only love, but that's all he's ever known.
Though,
he fell for her. This was his bride, and then his mother took that from him.
He needed to follow in the footsteps of the Stark children. If you don't, like, toughen up and, you know, play dirty, that's what happens to you.
Yeah. Dennis, you didn't shed a tear.
No. I mean, look, this is is a show.
Sorry.
Yeah.
In real life, if that happens, of course I'm going to be, you know.
Right,
gonna,
of course.
This is a TV show and a TV character, so I can say those
things. No one's saying you advocate suicide.
Well, you know, some people, you know. Right. Trust me. If I don't state that, you know, people will be going all over the place.
I've known you 10 years. I think you're a monster now.
Yes,
you're a monster.
So, I thought it was beautifully shot as well. And, you know, we saw Lancel, he also died. And you saw the explosion of the wildfire, and that was from the vision that Bran had before.
Right.
You know, with the Mad King and the explosion of the wildfire. Because remember, the Mad King didn't actually explode the
wildfire.
No, because
Jaime stopped him. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Robert Baratheon eventually. Real quick, let's touch upon the Grandmaster Pycelle, everything. Like, why do we... This is an interesting thing, because to see him getting out of bed with, we imagine, as a prostitute or whatever, because she asked for the money or whatever, the fact that it put a little, like, spin on him that's a little bit dirtier, and then having these little kids come in, which is Qyburn's little... Little birds, just like Varys had before, coming in and stabbing him, Julius Caesar-like. You know, there's a lot of Shakespearean references, which we'll get to eventually as we go through. But what did you think about this death for him? Because it put me in the mindset that he had been is sexually abusing children while he... Like, I don't know.
Didn't get that from it, because we've seen him before with prostitutes. For me, the scene was about, you know, Qyburn saying, oh, in order to usher in the new, we've got to take out the old or get rid of the old, and he's the old, and Qyburn's the new, just like Cersei's the new queen.
Why not him just stab him? Yeah. Why all the little birds have to get a piece? That's what I was wondering about.
I guess maybe to show that, like, that's he has control, I guess, over
his own little gang.
Yeah.
What'd you think about that, Perry?
Well, it's right in there in the quote. It's kind of like he's taking on that role, and now he's going to go out there with her. And I was trying to figure out what might have happened had he not been stabbed right then and there. Mm-hmm. Like, if he might have gotten caught up in the chaos and the explosion. I was trying to figure out, obviously, why he had to be killed that way as well.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it was very clear to me after one watch, but I'm curious to watch it again and listen. Because that one line that you just said is, before we can usher in the new, the old must be put to rest.
Yeah.
That, to me, defined the entire scene.
Yeah.
But how chilling to have to see kids committing murder so violently. Whatever, I know it's Game of Thrones, but still, these are you would think they're innocent kids. They're supposed to be a spy network. I didn't think they were assassins too.
Yeah,
fits with the theme, well, somewhat of a theme of the entire season with Arya going at, like, young kids going out and killing and doing all this kind of stuff.
Well, and we have Cersei really. Before we get to Cersei walking down that aisle and becoming
queen,
the queen on the Iron Throne, she tortures the nun
which was, you know, it was you know, a cruel scene, but at the same time kind of funny in a way, just because she's throwing everything back at her. She's like, confess, and then she kind of confesses her own stuff to her, and then later she's like, shame. We finally got to see the mountain's face.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Not as scary as I thought it would be, actually. I thought it would be worse.
Let's see some of Avatar's dates. Let's see as scary as I thought.
My nightmares were worse of his face.
But it's fascinating because she tortures her, but it feels like she tortures her beyond, because Cersei did do some terrible stuff. No, maybe she didn't deserve to be walked naked. Whatever. Yeah. Maybe she wasn't the one to make her walk naked and make her do the shame stuff. But she certainly deserved some kind of retribution for the stuff that she had done through the first 4 or 5 seasons before that happened. So, to me, it put her over the edge of her revenge. Like, it went beyond. But that's Cersei, right? Yeah. And she's going to keep torturing. I mean, because essentially what we believe is the mountain raped her in that, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that what's happening? Her screams are... Don't you think?
I think you see him kind of unbuckling his business.
Yeah, that's where my mind was going.
Yeah.
Jonathan, did you
zombie
think that
rape?
Too?
That's a whole new low.
God.
Wow.
Frankenstein.
Yeah.
Well, it was still like a very oddly satisfying moment for a villain to be able to put her down like that, because it's not that the nun just went after Cersei. She also went after Marjorie and Loras,
too. I was thinking it would be nice for Marjorie to share that moment with
the
Cersei.
The fact that they had felt the wrath of her as well made her torture a little too satisfying.
Yeah.
But Cersei's also kind of, I think I said this earlier, she's a villain I kind of love to hate. It's she's evil. She's like the worst of the worst. This episode in particular clearly just like laid that out for us. But, when she gets these little moments, I can't help but to crack a smile.
It's hard to give her these moments, though, after what you just saw her do. You know what I mean? Mm. And killing all those people in and then watching the children kill the Maester, and right. and it's kind of like, yeah, I guess you got your revenge, but you suck.
But this is great. This is a great point you bring up, Jonathan, because Game of Thrones does that with her through the entire series. Like, they get, she has her moments of revenge, but then there's always this under, there's mm-hmm. always this price that she doesn't expect to pay for her revenge. There's always a consequence for her revenge, and her consequence was Tommen jumping sure. out the window. You know, these are, oh, there are always prices that she has to pay that she doesn't anticipate paying because she doesn't think ahead just that little extra bit.
We didn't really see the anguish over Tommen the way
no.
you
no, no, her. No, no, I think yeah. she's. Maybe have has already accepted
she's
it
dead.
From yeah. the well, prophecy. Dead you know, we didn't talk about the prophecy yeah. that she had with that one. It was
yeah.
a witch.
The witch, yeah, in the wood when she was a teenager.
Telling about how, yeah, hard all her children were going to die before yeah. her, and it was almost like she knew it was coming, even though she had the mountain stop
Ooh,
him from going to
point.
The trial. Mm. I think it's almost like she knew.
And, I yeah. had completely misinterpreted that in recent episodes where I kind of thought she was at this point she was kind of like screw Tommen, I just got to get what I want. Yeah. I don't think it was that, but I think that's why we didn't see her grieve quite as much, because yeah, she knew it.
Well, she did I mean, in that scene, doesn't she say you know, her brother and her sister are buried, burn him yeah. and throw his ashes in the Sept.
Yeah,
it's almost like that's what he gets. He doesn't get you know, he doesn't get to be with his brother and sister.
I right. think it's more of an, she's accepted it though. I mm-hmm. think it's not so much she's mad at Tommen, because she still loves her children. It's right. just more of like, this is the life. That's why she changed into all that all black. Yeah. It's almost like she's assuming that mantle yeah. now. Like, okay, I'm going to be the true villain.
Yeah, well, you would think it's a mourning robe. It looked more like, I mean, to me, it really had reminiscent of the costumes in Dune, that 1980s film. Mm-hmm. You had that kind of, like, regalness, but then this darkness to it.
It also felt a little bit like Sansa with Rickon, that just, I have to step up. There's mm-hmm. more that's being called for from me now than, yeah. like, not having the luxury of mourning, sort of. She had to assume the throne.
It could also be that she's just dead inside now. This is her yeah. last connection to humanity, yeah. her last connection to the world. Now, there's nothing to stop her from being the ultimate villain
well,
as we go into
season we saw that
seven.
At the end when Jaime, you know, mm-hmm. rides yes. back, sees the burning. He knows yeah. there's something wrong going on, yeah. fear, urgency, heads down there and sees her being basically crowned yeah. as the queen. And even as she sees him, it's not a look of like, oh, you're back. And thank God you're back. No. You know, it was something completely different.
Mm-hmm. Right. There was not even, there's just a stare yeah. and then back to what she has to handle.
Yeah, like, this is me now. Yeah. Like,
even the
you.
People in the audience didn't look too thrilled to yeah. see her be crowned. I don't know. I'm very curious to see what the general public thinks and
yeah,
how they're going to respond to her role.
Yeah. I can't imagine that she has the support of anybody at this point.
Yeah. I kept expecting to see Arya in the crowd, the
right.
version of Arya mm-hmm. in the crowd from what we saw. I think what's interesting is if you follow Jaime's look to her there in that moment, if you remember the conversation that he had first with Edmure mm-hmm. and then later with Brienne, where they are undercutting this relationship that he has with Cersei, it makes him question. And so the look he has, I think, is that first time ever that he is questioning his relationship with Cersei and what the ramifications are. Because the consequence, having, you know, incest with your sister, this is all, the kids are dead. Like, it's just kind of this sign, like, maybe we shouldn't have done that.
If your sister is Cersei, I think that there are probably plenty of other people that are capable of having children by way of incest that survive. But she's a...
well, the Targaryens, look, the Targaryens are yeah. based on incest. The brothers and sisters
That's
married.
That's true. That's so. A good point. You're right. You're right. That's a good point, Jonathan. Well, apparently. Okay, I'm telling you, it's an interesting world. What have we...
Defender of incest.
We're like, interesting.
So we've defended suicide, incest. We're doing a great job.
No, the suicide crushed me. Anti-suicide, pro-incest.
Oh, boy.
Oh, Lord. All right. So let's move forward into Dorne. So this leads us into Dorne because Lady Tyrell goes to visit Ilaria Sand, and they come into some pact yeah. about what they're going to do next, and obviously to do revenge on Cersei. Olenna, Lady Tyrell, seems also strangely unaffected mm-hmm. by it all, wearing her black robes, still being the balls out awesome woman that she is, shutting the other sand snakes down. It's so brilliant. Anybody want to jump in? What'd you
I
think?
Don't think she was shut off in the same sense Cersei was. No. I very clearly saw that she
oh, yes.
was pissed.
Okay.
She was pissed, and she wants them to help her take them down.
Right.
I mean, that was a really well-written scene right there, too, with just the verbal, not even really verbal sparring, but yeah. her just, like, crushing everybody else. So if we had to return to Dorne in this final episode, I think this is kind of the little scene I would have wanted to see.
It is interesting to see that Olenna and Cersei are actually kind of on the same playing field now in that they have no bloodline. That's it. They've had everything that would have carried on their name wiped out. I mean, Jaime and Cersei could have more children, but I don't see that in their futures.
Yeah. Well, Jonathan, what did you think of Lord Varys showing up there right at the end?
Well, I was going to say that was probably the best part of that scene for me. I mean, I loved Ma Tyrell and her quips and against the Sand Snakes. And she's a woman that's... she really had no power at that point, and it was kind of like, well, what are you going to offer me? Because she says that. What do you have to offer me? And seeing Lord Varys, that it ties it all together, then you realize, oh, well, the Dornish are obviously working with the Targaryens now.
Right.
And here's your revenge.
Right.
Fire.
And by extension, Dany, by extension, the Dothraki, by extension, all of that.
Yeah, because Varys comes in and says the house motto of the Targaryens, fire and blood.
Fire and blood.
I didn't expect this kind of union in terms of the Tyrells and Dorne, but I didn't expect Cersei to kill all the Tyrells because I think kind of a mistake because the Lannisters don't have the money that they used to, and that's why they brought in the Tyrells. I thought she was going to kill the High Sparrow and all those people, but I didn't expect, you know, Loras and Margaery to go, and Mace and all them. And Olenna says, the Lannisters have now declared war on the Tyrells, where I don't know if Cersei saw it that way. She just wanted to get rid of her obstacles.
And you could make the argument now that she is the Mad Queen. Like, you can make this argument using the wildfire, having no kids, certainly a possibility.
Had she paired with the Tyrells, Tommen would still be alive. She may actually have a shot at having anybody that supports her. Now it seems she's got only enemies. And that's
I'd be curious to go back and rewatch that scene that they had like 2-3 episodes of them talking together, because we were busy trying to decipher what it meant back then. I bet you anything, if we go back and watch that, we'll be able to see little hints of what happened now that.
And I know Avital will get mad at me, but I'm going to bring this back to Tommen. If Tommen had actually stepped up and done what he could have done...
As a 12-year-old.
Well, instead of kowtowing to the High Septim in that one sequence, the Tyrells were in the city. They were going to take out the Faith Militant. Mm-hmm. And then had that happened, they wouldn't have... You know, he would have been back with Marjorie.
Right.
Back that was Marjorie. That wasn't Tommen coming back to him, making very few decisions up until his suicide. You can tell that was
Definitely Marjorie's influence as well. Mm-hmm. So, but Tommen is just like, he could have, you know.
I expect more from Marjorie. She's been smarter than this.
Well, her plan though was a far. Yeah. Like she was like
that was a long con.
Yeah, she was trying to do. Okay, I'm going to pretend.
Yeah.
I'm part of this. Yeah. Religion, and I'm faithful.
But
and
we
I'm
saw
do a...
Cersei make that mistake. She gave the High Sparrow power because she saw it as something that would help her, and it backfired. And maybe she wasn't privy to Cersei's mistake, but I could see you don't want to ally yourself with these people because it's not going to work out for you.
Yeah, well, it might have been an alliance of convenience that would have helped out in the long run. But I think what Perry brings up is correct. The scene between them a couple episodes ago, Olenna let it be known that she was not going to be aligned with Cersei. She insulted her. She said she's the reason. So whatever possibility existed there disappeared with that conversation. And I think Cersei got the idea, or cemented the idea, to blow that, to use the wildfire.
But that took place after the whole almost walk of shame.
Oh, right, with
Olenna and Cersei. That happened after they could have done something.
Yes, yes, yes. But it seemed like. Anyway, all right, so let's move on to something a little more brighter, a little more lighter. Sam and Gilly traveling. They finally arrived to Old Town. They see the Citadel. They're getting there just in time to see the White Ravens leaving the Citadel, which signifies that winter is finally here after six seasons. And Sam is to be the new maester. So what... Jonathan, what'd you think about this? I know you kind of a special enjoyment of the Sam and Gilly storyline. What did you feel about this at this point?
The first thing I thought of when he finally walked into that library, into the main hall, I don't know if you guys have ever played Oblivion, but it kind of reminded me of scenes of Oblivion. It's a game on. But, I'm glad he made it to Old Town. I did love seeing all those White Ravens. Mm-hmm. At first, I was thinking, oh my God, is that like... Is that because of what just happened in King's Landing?
Right.
Because that's where my head was just kind of going. Mm-hmm. And of course, when we see the one white raven get to Winterfell, it's like, of course, winter's here. Right. But it brought a little sunshine, let's say, in a in an otherwise fairly dark episode.
Yeah.
You can always count on Sam and Gilly, but you know, I didn't take as much from that. I'm just kind of wondering, you know, what is he going to discover there now? That's what right. I'm excited for. It's like him getting there. Okay, whatever. Like, what are we going to learn?
Yeah. Perry, what'd you think?
Yeah, I mean, I pretty much felt the same way. I wouldn't say I took any big, huge revelation from it, but at the same time, had this episode not included any of them, I think I would have been feeling a little cold with that storyline. Yeah. I needed to see him, you know, reach some sort of goal. But then again, it's, you know, you reach one goal, and then you look at all that space, and, like, he's got his work cut out for him, and I'm just curious where Gilly is off to now. Is he just going to go through all those books, and she's just going to chill in the hallway there?
Yeah, the whole time.
Yeah, right. Dennis, what did you
think? For me, I'll tie this back to something totally different.
Tommen? No.
No, okay. Not Tommen. But, you know, there's been a lot of discussion, or people are talking about Sansa, and why didn't she tell Jon Snow that the Knights of the Vale were coming, right. And my whole reasoning for that is that she wasn't sure that they were coming. She had sent that letter out, but she wasn't sure if they were going to come or when she was going to show up, if they were going to show up in time.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that was the reason. And this scene where Sam is trying to get into this Maester school, they're like, oh, we don't know who Jon Snow is.
Right.
They still think Mormont is the Lord Commander. They think Aemon is still alive. So. Yeah. Things don't try. We joked about it. There's no text message, and you're texting people. You know what I mean? Hey, Knights of the Vale coming? Yeah, sure. We'll be there.
There's no printing press.
Yeah, so communication and information, it doesn't travel that fast.
Yeah.
It does further highlight everything else that had just happened in King's Landing, too. Like, imagine them trying to update the book now.
Yeah, right. Dead. But yeah, I thought it was a lighter tone. It was funny. He said life is irregular.
Yes.
The scene of... I thought it was nice to see Sam and seeing the library and all the books, the sense of awe and wonderment that he had. Because he's one of the few characters that would actually experience that at a place like that.
Yeah. I enjoyed it myself because I think it showed you that Sam is going to be a more integral part of season 7. We kind of saw him a little bit in this season, but him having the access to this information will make him invaluable in whatever war is coming, the Great War. I think, Jonathan, you said something like his goal was to find out how to kill the White Walkers.
Right.
This is going to give him more information, possibly be able to do that, and who knows what we... And we saw science, like you saw those contraptions. I mean, it was almost Da Vinci-like what we saw up there. So what more is he going to learn and discover? And you know Jon Snow is going to need him in the battle and is going to use his knowledge intensely in the battle. What did you think of it?
I think it's about time. Come bringing it back to Tommen. I don't love the Sam and Gilly storyline. I'm sure it will start to pay off, but I have a cold at heart, I guess.
Yeah, no. You hate love.
I was
unless
for
it's
Tommen
brother and sister love.
Yeah,
right.
Siblings. Pro incest. Hashtag
like
hate love.
I like Tommen being in love. I guess you know, Sam is largely useless.
Whoa, boy.
He's got brains.
He's got the brain.
Everyone's going to hate me for saying that. No, he, and that's
Tom
where.
And anti-Sam.
That's where I think it'll be nice to see Sam come into his own and have something to bring to the table. Mm-hmm. And I think, yes, he'll be invaluable when the White Walkers come. Yeah. But for now, I've just been like, I want to see everything else that's going on. I didn't need that little bit of levity. I would have been fine without it. Although the library looked cool.
Back to the book, though, isn't it really sad that all it takes to, like, kill someone, just cross your name out. That's it. Because I think someone else said it maybe in this episode or another one before. Oh, it was the speech to Ramsay. Like, you will be forgotten. Your name will be forgotten. It is as easy as a line right through it and you're done.
We're gonna talk about maybe later on in this show, but like, there's a lot of... To me, the whole episode had this like little undercurrent of being very subversive about the end of religion, about the unnecessary aspects and consequences of religion. The blowing up of the Sept, that's blowing up the High Sparrow. You have here science very much in awe, very much revered, you know, those kinds of things. And then eventually as we go forward, I just want to highlight it now before we go forward. Anyway, all right. I think that's enough for Sam and Gilly, yes? All right, let's move on to Bran and his situation over there by the Weirwood tree with Benjen and with Meera. What did we think about this, Avital? What did you think?
I thought it was very interesting. We were talking about this after the show, that they don't specifically say that it's Rhaegar who's the father, and I've wondered if...
Oh, and you're going right to the vision.
Oh,
all
yeah,
right,
yeah.
Okay.
Should we just...
No, ahead. Do your thing, yeah.
Talk about the
tree. No.
Go ahead.
Well, we knew that that's what it was gearing up for. You know, hearing the shrieks, I knew it was going to be the birth. We were going to see Jon Snow. But I do think it's interesting. Obviously, the fans had caught up to this point, and we all knew that was the prevalent theory. And I don't know if they're trying to hold out and suggest that it might not be exactly what we think, or if it is just they understand that we assume and we fill in the blanks. So I'm curious about that. It was cool to see it finally happen. There's something, I think, that could be disappointing when everybody's expecting something and then you see it play out as expected, that instead is really exciting because it feels familiar and new at the same time. It's almost like deja vu. I'm getting corny, I thought that was really satisfying to see.
Well, we don't hear what she says first, and then she says, if Robert finds out, he'll kill him. That is audible. Everything else is kind of whispered, and then we cut to Jon Snow. So we assume that that's what the prophecy
is. Does Bran know? That's what I'm curious about. Does he understand the full thrust of who Jon Snow is, or does he just know, oh, my father wasn't this dishonorable, unfaithful man that he was sort of punished for being? And it was sad to hear earlier, you know, Jon Snow talk about how he didn't get to sit at the table with them.
Right.
And Catelyn was sort of punishing him and Ned by not really letting him be part of the family. And this whole time, it, you know, was for nothing. So it's kind of heartbreaking to see, even though we all knew.
And think about all the stuff Ned had to go through with his wife and his family. And, you know, he's such an honorable person that he had to basically admit to something he really didn't do to protect Jon Snow.
Yeah. Well, there's so much about Lyanna that stretches into... even now, like, stretches into so many different storylines, just making that decision and what Ned had to do. If all of this doesn't happen, it's the price for love, right? Because she was very much in love and had the Rhaegar, right? Has the child with Rhaegar, right? Is that what, and so,
well, that's what the theory is,
right? Theory. I mean,
yeah, that's the thing. Avital saying, I'm saying they're just doing it just to tease every you know, they show that little part. In a few episodes before, they show this little part, they're just eking out little bits of information. It's like, you know it is, but they're just holding back just the confirmation. I mean, come on, she's like whispers in his ear. Why?
Yeah, and they cut to Jon Snow and the prophecy that earlier about Cersei's kids. What did you think about this whole season?
I don't think they would do it the way they did it this episode and then have it not be the case and proven wrong. Yeah. But I'll agree with what you said, Avital. I cannot believe how something that you know and is something that's been so widely discussed can still be so satisfying when you see it on screen. It's like, didn't even matter that the whole idea, because I read up on the idea, so I had never read the books and I didn't know what the Tower of Joy was, and the Tower of Joy was then spoiled for me because I did too much research. And still, I guess it wasn't spoiled, actually, because I was very satisfied by this scene. Yeah. It's a nice little bookend, too. Yeah. It's interesting to see an infant Jon Snow cut to the commander Jon Snow and then thinking about him being resurrected earlier in the season. So I think it shaped the whole season very nicely.
As long as... they didn't pull Saving Private Ryan. If you guys have seen that.
Right.
With the little fake out with the fade.
You got some serious beef with Saving Private Ryan.
You can't do that, you know? Like, imagine if they did that for this. They just did a cut from the baby to Jon Snow.
Yep.
Imagine in a later episode they reveal, it's not going to happen, guys.
Right.
But they revealed that baby was not Jon Snow, right?
Right.
How would you feel about that? Well, that's what Saving Private Ryan does.
Next week, there will be no Game of Thrones recap. It'll just be Dennis tearing apart Saving Private Ryan.
You know what? Saving Private Ryan is an awesome movie. Yeah. They just didn't need that.
And if you haven't had enough Saving Private Ryan, on June 29th here on Collider, the top 10 show, we're counting on the top 10 Spielberg movies.
Right?
And guess what film shows up? But we'll talk about that
very
later. Jonathan, is there anything you want to talk about with this?
Because
I want to talk about Benjen Stark. Is there anything you want to...
Okay, so that's what I was going to hop
please
into.
Bring that up.
I think we covered that, but as far as Baby John, but...
Yeah.
But I just love that Benjen, you know, reveals, and we kind of knew it, but it's not just ice and stone that makes the wall. It's a ward. It's a magical ward that keeps the White Walkers away.
Yeah.
Now, my only question is, if Bran has that burn on his hand, if it let him into Three-Eyed Raven's domain, is it going to be able to lead them through the wall, or is that only a one-time thing?
Right.
I don't know.
It's a good question, and we wonder now because, Benjen says, while it stands, the dead cannot pass. Mm. You know, he cannot pass. So you know that wall is going to come down at some point, which of course, leads into the Jon Snow. And they keep talking about the Great War, the Great War, the Great War, and he even later on when Jon Snow is there at the wall and he talks to the House of the Lords, Lords of the North, rather, it's all about the Great War. You know, everything that's happening, we're watching on all these episodes, all this season, there is White Walkers coming. So all this humans, little stuff that they've got going on, there's real death coming.
Real danger.
With no emotional stuff, no love issues, no incest stuff, no suicides. It's straightforward death that's coming.
Cut to me when you say that.
Way to go, Frank.
I mean, the one little thing, though, of the Benjamin stuff that I was like, really? He leaves a crippled boy, his crippled nephew on the ground, and he takes the horse with him. He's like, hey, go ahead. You'll be just fine. You're the little girl. Go ahead. I'll get on the horse.
I wish you the best, and I'm out of here. But it's good to see that Benjen came back. I was really happy to see that. Perry, is there anything more you wanted to add with him?
I would have liked to have spent a little more time with Benjen. Because how many episodes was he in?
Two or three.
At this point, he's just a plot device.
It was the intro, something in the middle, and then an exit.
Right.
So, I'm hoping that we see him next season. And based on what he just teased with the wall, I have a feeling we will.
Yeah. Okay, that's enough of the light stuff. Let's move back into the darkness and go to the twins with Walder Frey, Bronn, and Jaime Lannister, and a disguised Arya. So let's talk about that. Jonathan, you want to start us off?
Do you want to jump right into the Big Bang?
Whatever you want to do.
Let's ease into this. Let's talk about the little conversation between Jaime and him before that.
Jaime and who? Walder?
Jaime and Walder Frey. Where he sat down, he's like, oh, you can make fun of me, I don't care. And we've heard Walder say that before. Mm-hmm. You think I care what you guys think? People fear me. And Jaime's like, dude, come on. if it wasn't for us, Blackfish would still be sitting in River Run. They fear Lannisters, not you. And we've how long are you gonna stay valuable? Which, okay, that kind of gave it away in the dialogue. Like, okay, well, his number's up now.
Yeah.
So kind of foreshadowed that. And then you see the waitress. I don't know if she's a waitress.
Serving wench? I'm not trying to be mean. Serving wench, probably.
Serving wench?
I'm not going to go waitress.
Waitress.
She's like bringing them their food.
Here's
whatever,
your bill,
you know?
Sir. Yeah, right.
It's in Chili's.
Yeah. It's a little chilly. It's the north. It's the Riverlands. But.
Jonathan, boom. Nailed it.
Which is here,
Puns aplenty.
Anyway, no, but... But we see her again, and you're just like, okay, something's up when he says, oh, you're not one of mine.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And then she's cutting that meat pie. And as I'm watching, I'm just like, she's getting a little like creepy with her dialogue, And then she's like, once you see that finger, you're like, oh, man. Oh, my God. It's Arya. Before she even whips off that thing, it was like... So great.
It was so great to watch it with you because everyone started screaming, oh, wait, that's Arya, right before the reveal happened. I played Titus Andronicus in school. For me, that was a particularly awesome thing to see that he had baked the kids, his own kids, into the pie, which is what happens at the end of Titus. Spoiler alert. Can we talk about that conversation real quick, though, between Walder and Jaime? It seemed to me we knew it was the end of Walder, but it was also Jaime kind of saying, we don't need these useless people anymore. Like, he's saying he wants to have a little more control over the situation. It's his way of coming back to King's Landing because that's what Cersei kind of like told him to do a couple episodes ago. Dennis, what did you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, it was more they were helping them out because they owed them for the Red Wedding.
Right.
They betrayed the Starks, and so this is like, look, you guys can't take care of your shit, so we came to take care of it for you. Don't pretend that you have things handled. And he was just very dismissive of him. And with the Arya thing, like as soon as they cut to that one shot of just Walder Frey there by himself, I was like, okay, Arya's coming. She's here. I didn't know she was going to do the whole like kill the sons and put it in the pie thing, but she's starting. Well, not starting. She's already been down this path of being a sociopath, psychopath killer. I mean, in terms of murdering, she's smiling. She has a look of elation on her face. I mean, it's definitely revenge.
Yeah.
But there's still something something off in her mind.
Okay. Maybe I'm a sociopath.
Maybe.
I think if you're going to do revenge, you should enjoy your revenge. I think there's nothing wrong with it. Perry, what did you think? What did you think about this sequence and what Arya pulled?
First, the conversation. I liked seeing Jaime kind of play the game a little and let you know where he stands in all this before he went back to King's Landing. So that really served the character well for me. Another random thing I took from that conversation, I'm pretty sure someone said Edmure is back in his cell.
Yeah.
God, that poor guy. Like, what does he have? Like, nobody will give him a break ever. And
so I guess his deal didn't hold up then.
I kind of feel bad for him.
Well,
and
his
then,
deal did, didn't because his family isn't dead. That
they didn't
was
catapult
the
his son.
Yeah,
so
that was kind of a big deal. That.
And then, of course, we have the big moment. And yeah. I want to say the scene in and of itself played very, very well for me. It, yeah. You know, it foreshadowed what was happening just enough that I was playing along with it, and it was building and building and building before it actually happened, so yeah. that when it happened, it was that much more satisfying. In terms of a full season arc for Arya,
yeah.
I'm a little disappointed. It feels like to me there were bits and pieces that I was like, oh, this is great, but in terms of it coming together as a whole, and I know this was the whole point to turn her into an assassin yeah. so she could start doing these things, but it didn't feel as smooth as I think I wanted it to. Okay. So I think this could have gotten an extra little boost if it had been smoother throughout the entire season.
I would tell you.
I'll agree with you that I think Arya's storyline was sort of the weakest over the season, and there was so much potential, and I don't think they really delivered on that potential. Of course, it was satisfying to see her get her revenge. I do wonder, maybe I missed something, but how Jaime managed to escape her clutches. It seems like she would have taken him out while she was there, too. Mm. I'm glad she didn't, of course. I love Jaime. And to your point again, you're saying it was a nice, you liked that bit of character of seeing him engage that way with Walder Frey. I thought it was very out of character for him, but in an interesting way because he has changed so much over the seasons. He was such a villain. I mean, you almost forget that Bran can't walk because of him yeah. and Cersei. Mm-hmm. And he now is such a three-dimensional character, such a likable character, and usually he just seems like he doesn't care enough to engage that way, mm-hmm. to have the conversation that he did with Walder Frey, and for some reason, and maybe this is like the romantic in me, but I almost felt like maybe it was pangs of regret over the wedding that made him feel like he had to tell him off yeah. a little bit.
And I think that's fair.
And it supports Jaime becoming this sort of soulful man that we haven't seen before. And then I'm with you, maybe I'm a sociopath too, but I felt like, yeah, Arya, like you enjoy that death.
Yeah.
You
well,
earned
yeah,
it.
Yeah, as a viewer, I, well, sure. I was very satisfied. I'm sure. Talking about her as a person.
Her
you know?
As a person, though, like this is her.
Usually, if someone wiped out my entire family, yeah, I would yeah, but, enjoy yeah. the vengeance.
This is more anger based. Yeah. I feel well, like if someone hurt your family and you went to take revenge, you would be angry.
Yes, true.
Not
That's
happy.
A fair point.
Well, but she's been angry.
Right.
And so this is, I think, her deliberately acceptance. Trying to savor that moment.
Well, Sansa's in the same position, that big fat grin on her face mm-hmm. after yeah. Ramsay was eaten alive. So.
Yeah, the Stark girls are really getting theirs.
Well, this is something I want to bring up with Arya. What did she, is she now the, what would you say, the marriage between the House of Black and White and her vengeance? Is she the perfect assassin now in that she's, because she's not being assigned to kill people. She has her list. Now she's learned how to do it. Jakar gave her the ammunition to be able to do it even more effectively than she would have done before. Is this why she's such an assassin in her way that to her it's almost just vengeance and nothing else?
You know what I think is interesting, getting into the theology of Game of Thrones, which is so complex and there are so many different gods, and do they kind of support each other? And I believe the whole thing with the House of Black and White is that it's all death,
right.
God of death, and every religion has their version of death, so they're not at odds with each other, the various religions, but it seems that they all adhere to this principle of you don't do anything out of revenge, you don't do anything because you have a personal attachment to it, and Arya is the embodiment of personal, it's all personal,
yeah. Yeah.
But she has this power anyway, so to me that suggests that the god, the faceless,
yeah.
the god of death has selected Arya,
yeah.
and that maybe doesn't want to be served in this way without emotion, without attachment. And yeah, it was interesting because we didn't know for sure if she would have this power, and mm. then she does, and somebody gave it to her. I don't think it's as simple as she just cuts off a face. Mm, it
yeah.
seems like the god, the gods, whatever we want to call them, have shined on Arya.
Yeah.
But the big question, though, in that regards, did Jaqen know that this is the path? Because it's kind of hinted
yeah.
at with his smile at the end of the episode, No One.
Yeah.
Did this whole time that, you know, from the moment that she helped him escape, did he know that this is the path that he was going to take her down, and know that she never was going to be part of the Faceless Assassin,
yeah.
and that she was going to go down this path where and be able to still use those abilities and all the training and everything that she learned to accomplish her task? Did
yeah.
he know, and was
so in a sense,
he
a
complicit?
Gift to her?
Yeah, was
yeah.
he complicit?
It's a good
with that?
Question.
Well, I feel like he is. Yeah.
She came to him, though. I mean,
yeah.
She crossed the sea and came to him in
right.
Braavos. But, I mean,
he's still
as far as once she arrived, sure.
Yeah.
definitely seems that he has a fondness for her. That maybe he didn't know it would play out the way that it did, but he hoped. I definitely get the sense that he hoped, but I wonder how much he really knew.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. All right, let's move on to the next big granddaddy of them all, Winterfell. Let's talk about everything that happened in Winterfell. We have Jon Snow, we have Melisandre, we have Ser Davos, we have Sansa, we have Lords of the North. We have so much to talk about. Let's kick it off. Dennis, you want to start us off on this?
Yeah, I mean, let's start off with the stuff with Davos and Melisandre, because we know that was brewing, especially with the look that Davos gave to Melisandre last episode. Yeah. It came to a head, you know, the anger, the emotion that he felt. He said, like, he felt like Shireen was his own daughter. And right. It seemed like a Jon Snow thing to do, where he's not going to kill her because she did bring him back to life
right. And
made it possible, the Battle of the Bastards. And so, but she didn't kill him, but exiles her. So I feel like that was kind of a fair, but I mean, I'm sure Davos doesn't feel that way, but a fair decision.
Yeah, this is an interesting question, because Melisandre does not get redeemed just because she brought Jon Snow back to life. She did a lot of terrible stuff. She was cocky. She was really disrespectful to anybody who would question her power over Baratheon. And I mean, sorry, did I say that right?
Stannis.
So I just want to make sure. To me, I didn't exactly like Jon Snow's decision. I accepted it because she brought him back to life, but I wasn't 100% happy for it.
Because you thought that she should have been
killed.
Yeah.
Executed.
I think he should have let Ser Davos do what he needed to do. Hmm. And I thought what was interesting there in that moment is that Ser Davos finally gets one up on Melisandre, because for seasons Melisandre was one up on Davos the whole time, when Davos was trying to tell Stannis to not do certain things and not do certain things, and Melisandre kept saying he doesn't know anything, he's a peasant. Remember when he made fun of her made fun of him in prison when he was locked down there with Shireen? She was a very terrible person for a long time.
Oh, she's not a good person at all. I think she's a terrible person. Yeah. But I just feel like, and then he
and
also
burned the child alive.
Yeah. And then he did ask her to bring Jon Snow. This
right.
before
yeah. Davos did. Yeah.
What worries me, the Starks have a habit of being fair but not smart.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think Jon sending her away was the fair thing to do, but I think she's right when she says, you're going to need me. And he's been so focused on the White Walkers are all of our enemy. We have to think big. And she, in the big picture, is an asset, and he has now sent her away. I'm hoping she's kind of like Ser Jorah and comes back and just eventually can, you know, be so helpful that he can't keep sending her away. But I don't think it's a smart move.
Well, I mean, Davos said like, "Oh, you lied." It's like, and she's like, "No, I didn't lie. I was just wrong."
Yeah.
It's not like she purposely wanted to kill Shireen.
Sure. I mean, I feel like
it's
doing this
about the High Sparrow.
Going like this, but okay.
I think you could say the same thing about the High Sparrow. I'm sure he believed everything.
He seemed more power hungry, though, in my mind.
Fairy, what'd you think?
He definitely seemed more manipulative. Whereas, even though they've painted Melisandre as a big fat villain the entire time up until pretty much this season.
Yeah.
I think that she always did really believe in what she's preaching
That's true.
And it's almost like an impossible argument for her to have, because she can't win, because it's not like anyone else she's talking to right now understands the extent to which she understands this kind of stuff. But I knew this moment was coming, obviously, and I was very much looking forward to it. And I think I wanted so many different things out of it that no matter what, I was going to be happy. So I liked how it played out. But I kind of wanted to see Jon Snow execute her just to see what happens if that happens.
You're like, could he even?
Yeah. I'm glad, though, she's still in play. And I agree, it's not a smart move for her to say. As that scene was playing out the entire time, I'm like, keep her. Because I knew she was going to prove to be an asset later on. But at the same time, I'm curious now to see where she ends up, because I wonder how much fight she has left in her. I can't see her just abandoning everything that she's been fighting for and pushing for all along, but at the same time, I mean, maybe that's kind of what they were teasing when we saw her all old and frail in the beginning. Maybe she's just broken.
Yeah. Jonathan?
She's down but not out, and if just to my way of thinking, it's like I'm putting myself in Snow's position. You mentioned she is an asset, and he needs to defuse this situation. So for now, she's banished from the north,
right. But
she's not dead. And it seemed like Davos was accepting of that. That's his lord's, you know, commandment.
Yeah.
She's heading south. I do suggest she divert around Brienne, because Brienne's not really happy with her either. But if she can get to the Brotherhood without banners, then, you know, maybe we'll still see her for the Targaryens making landfall.
Yeah,
so we'll see.
This is another point I want to make about this whole thing. Here we go. Exposing the fallacy of listening to the god or gods for guidance. Once again, we have these. I'm not supporting this. I'm just saying it seemed really obvious to the episode that they were undercutting religion at every moment they could. Her defense is that she was following what she thought was God's words or her God's words, God of Light, to tell her to do these things that she was doing, and she tried to validate it by saying, "Yes, the horses were this and this and this." But look, it worked. And then immediately Davos was like, "It worked for nothing because they all died anyway. It was a waste of time, you know." And then she's like, "Well, she told me to bring Jon Snow back." She says, "No, I asked you." You know, there's these things that we're kind of undercutting, and I think it's interesting to explore. And I love that Ser Davos, what we do in modern society, people who are religious, we ask God, "Why is this child? Why did my child die? Why was my child taken away? Why did my child get cancer at such a young age?" This is what Davos is saying to her. What kind of God would want you to sacrace a child? You know,
he said he was evil.
He said it was evil, and that's these little nuggets that I think that they're dropping through, and they've been dropping through the whole season about undercutting this stuff. So you know, well,
the dogma of religion. Not so much religion as a whole.
Yes, I'm sorry, Dennis. You're right. Yes, dogma of religion.
She kind of threw Shireen's mom under the bus in a way that I thought was a little unfair.
Oh yeah,
she did try to stop it. Mm-hmm. She was like, her father was for it, her mother was for it. Not totally.
Yeah,
calm down.
So we have that scene with Jon and Sansa on the top of the castle in Winterfell there. What do we think about that? She's saying, "You're a member of my family," and he's trying to, you know, "You forget that he's a bastard," or, you know, that he's considered because he's taken the mantle so strong. What did we think about that, Perry?
I just like the line that they need to trust each other.
Yeah.
Like, dear God, let someone on this show find someone that they could fully trust, because no one's going to be able to survive. I mean, really, some of the biggest power players lose because they wind up alone. I mean, well, not Cersei. Obviously, she's in the position she kind of wants to be, and she's by herself there. But I hope to God that the two of them could, you know, actually genuinely trust each other. I'm not entirely sure what she's thinking, though, if she's fully in there. I mean, she did admit to him, "Oh, I'm sorry I didn't tell you about Littlefinger and the Knights of the Vale," but I feel like she might be angling a little. I think she might have the understanding that we kind of just laid out, where John will be fair, but he isn't necessarily smart, and she's going to be the perfect little pairing for him if they will just stay together. But that shot of the two of them, how perfectly they fit in those pillars, or whatever you want to call them. They're not pillars. There's something else. But the way that they are framed so perfectly together, that to me says where they're going to go next season. I'm knocking the mic. Two of them are going to be a force to reckon with together, I hope.
I hope so, too.
Do you think they're going to have a romance?
No. No.
Hey, I'm asking a question.
It's worked out for some.
Yeah.
Not
and
for
they're
others.
Cousins. They're not. You catch me again, man.
No, go to the incest cam. No,
cousins is better than siblings. Oh, we now know that they're not direct siblings.
Okay. Just no more drinking before the show. I'm more worried about the idea that, I wonder, the reason I bring it up is because if we find out that Jon Snow is not necessarily 100% related to Sansa, then it could be possible, right? It could. I mean, they're cousins, so it still could work in a way.
I mean, I was wrong about Sansa making a deal with Peter Baelish, in the sense I thought it was some sort of either marriage arrangement,
right.
But I mean, it was still hinted at when they had the talk about that's what he wanted. He wanted the Iron Throne. He wanted her to be with him. Now that Catelyn's gone, of course, this is who he wants. And she turns him down. But at the same time, you know, what Perry was talking about, I think is true, where I think she's still going to hide stuff away from Jon Snow, because Jon Snow, even though he's probably one of the most honorable people on the show, he just doesn't have it to play the Game of Thrones. Where now she does. She has it now. Before, she used to be the most naive person on the show. She's changed. And Jon Snow, I think, is going to remain the way that he is.
Well, that's ironic. That's what I think is ironic. Jon Snow is the perfect Stark. He's following the footsteps of Ned in that way. Fair, but sometimes stupid.
That's
right?
Their fatal flaws. Yeah. Fairness and honor and sometimes naivete. They're just unwilling to, they won't play the game what Dennis said.
It's ironic that the men are doing this, while you see Sansa and Arya are not doing this and are very realistic about what the world is and how horrible the world, and they're thinking 4 or 5 steps ahead.
Sansa's had the best transformation on the show. Like, this to me is just the perfect example of a show not going crazy, needing to do like cliffhangers and big jumps and all these like big, bold, brash tactics to get people to talk. It is a character who has had the slowest transformation and had all these different things happen to her, and every single time you look at her, you could see everything from the past seasons. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's so mm-hmm. earned, her transformation. Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to throw something crazy out for a second. We were talking about, we didn't address it last week, but that exchange with Ramsay right before he's finished, where he says, you'll always have a part of me, I'll always be a part of you. The idea that maybe she's pregnant with Ramsay's baby, and in that case, would she potentially shack up with Littlefinger just to not have to admit
and just
that
say,
this
is it, like
Ramsay's
it's a
Bailey?
Yeah, it's possible. Baby. I think that's a good theory.
Let's see.
Must serve two evils. Yeah. I do. One thing about Sansa is, like, I love how she's playing it wise.
Yeah.
I really, really hope next season that continues, that we don't see her get, you know, deceived by Peter Baelish, whom she's already claimed, like, never trust that man. Mm-hmm. And she's, and when he went in for that creepy kiss, she's like, it's a nice dream, but, like, don't involve me.
I think she's playing him. I think she's going to angle it. And even if she does, let's say, get married or involved with him, she's going to know how to, at least she's better equipped now to play him.
And
it's
if she's doing it that way,
two
that's
adults
fine.
have a thing like that too. It's like they're two adults, but it's like, you know, a kid in school who has a crush on someone, like, oh, I'll give you my cookie if you give me a kiss or something. or just like that childish thing where someone leans in for a kiss and gets rejected.
Yeah,
and
awkward.
We're talking about two people playing with armies here and wanting to rule the whole area.
Still human beings, always at the bottom of the bottom of everything is still human beings. The cookie with the kiss thing, that still works. What I want to say real quick, what I really liked about this sequence is, it, in my mind, immediately it dawned on me, like, this is so interesting because the show gets so much flack for how it treats some of its female characters. But if things play out the way they're setting up, at the end of next season, we could have Dany on the throne, Sansa ahead of the North, and Yara ahead of the Iron Lands, right? And Iron Islands, rather. Don't kill me, Iron Islands. And so this is interesting. We could have them all, like, women in charge of almost the entire area there. And this is fascinating to me. I love this idea. Because if it plays out the way it's supposed to play out,
for the record, I don't think they're horrible to their female characters. They're just horrible to all of their characters.
No. Well, right, but I'm saying they do get flack for it.
Well, I think Sansa, though, she may be the head of Winterfell, like, behind the scenes. Because with what happened in this episode, because what happens with Jon Snow being named King in the North, you see Peter Baelish, he's like, this is not his plan, is that Sansa takes over.
Right.
He marries Sansa, therefore he has now power over Winterfell. And with Jon Snow effectively being that king in the North, that is against his plans.
Yeah. Well, that's
it was an interesting choice, actually, in that scene where they're all cheering for him as the king of the North.
Mm.
The last shot in that scene is on Sansa. So it's clearly telling you, look at what she's doing right now.
Yeah.
And It's a hard moment to decipher. Again, it's another thing that I want to go back and take a closer look when we can watch it again. Mm. But I think just, like, from a first instinct, she did seem proud of him and comfortable with him in that position. So hopefully that's a sign that she won't take Littlefinger's crap and just,
do
the right thing.
Mona Lisa type thing with Sansa a lot in these last few episodes, where you don't know whose team she's on. You can't really decipher her smile with Ramsay. You know where that smile's coming from as he's being eaten by his dogs. But a lot of the time you're like, whose team is she on? And as she said earlier, no one can protect anyone. So she's very aware of, she has to be kind of for herself first and foremost. But as the showrunners pointed out, the last time we heard them chanting the King of the North was for Robb Stark, who obviously things didn't work out very well for him.
Yeah.
And the cut to Littlefinger made me very worried for Jon Snow, because you see him kind of staring ominously in the corner. And you can't quite tell how Sansa feels about it.
But I feel like Sansa is the one that is going to protect Jon Snow from Peter Baelish.
I hope so.
That's what I think she is going to do stuff behind the scenes that Jon Snow is just not going to know about.
Yeah.
And how great was it if the internet didn't already love Lyanna Mormont?
I was just going to get to that.
Now she gives this speech.
Yeah.
She's talking about how she stood up for the Starks and how, what was that first, the Manderly?
Manderly,
you guys didn't do Glovers.
And Glover,
none of you guys did anything. And that was fantastic.
Yeah, I immediately thought, I wrote down here, she needs a spinoff. Like, I would be very happy if Lady Mormont had her own spinoff.
Her island.
You know, I mean, that child put everybody to shame.
Yeah, put them on blast.
Put them on blast, exactly.
It's fun to see
great.
All those grown men with swords take her so seriously, too. That makes it that much better.
Yeah.
She's so good.
Wait, she was like, you refused the call. She's basically calling them all a bunch of bitches. Like, you didn't do this, you didn't do that. Like, screw you. I'm this little girl, and I took my house of 62 men, and we fought.
And my boy steps up, he's like, she speaks harshly, but truly. Yes, and then puts the sword down, which is great. And I think what you bring up is right, is this whole feeling of the last time Sansa saw her brother be king of the North, bad things happened. So it's certainly possible, and Littlefinger lurking there, man, it just can't be a good thing. Did we like that whole scene with when he's rallying at the wall? Because at the wall, they're rallying everything. Like we have the arguments between the wildlings and the Vale, you know, all arguing about who. I think that ends any kind of division for now, don't you think?
Yeah.
Right.
I think it's also a storyline we don't need to see.
Yes. Well,
the point is too is that winter is here now, not winter is coming, and. Yeah. You know, those White Walkers are going to be coming through that wall if they are able to knock it down.
Yeah.
So I don't see... Things are rapidly progressing, so I don't see a whole lot of, like, Baelish-esque workings. Mm-hmm. Because Snow said, you know, our true... Because they're talking about, like, well, should we support him? Before they started saying, you know, the King of the North, King of the North. Okay. Snow had to say the true enemy won't wait out the storm. He brings the storm.
So powerful.
That's already on their doorstep.
Mm-hmm. But he's the one that's is leading the charge because, like we've seen on the show, the people in the South think it's ridiculous the idea of White Walkers. It's all myth. But the Lords of the North, houses of the North, they understand that it's a very real possibility. All right, let's jump into Meereen. We have Dany. We have Dario. We have. Love broken in this point. So all this stuff going on. Perry, what did you think about this whole stuff going in Meereen?
Poor guy.
Right?
I mean, he just did all that work for her and she's just like, I'm not having it. Most of all, I felt sorry for him. But it goes to show where her priorities lie. And it sets her up as, I don't know if ruthless is the right word, but she is hell-bent on achieving her goals and she's not going to let, you know, love
get in the way.
You know, maybe it's an example of the opposite of Jon Snow, someone doing what they have to do and not necessarily doing what's fair or what feels like true.
Yeah.
As in like, you know, love and going with your emotions and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But the part that I loved most about this, besides obviously seeing all the ships sailing away, is I like the moment for Tyrion. It feels like he earned that, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that's what this whole season was leading up to him. He was being dedicated and true to someone, and when she handed it, it was like, I mean, it was like a little kid getting an award or getting an A on a test. Like, something felt so right, and she's much better off for having him by her side.
Right, Queen of the Hand. Right.
Yeah,
Hand of the Queen.
I like what you said about him earning it, because before, when he was Hand of the King, it was more like he kind of coerced to become Hand of the King.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even an official title. He was just instead of his father because his father was out fighting.
Right.
And this was something that was earned. And I, you know, with Dany, it's like, she's so cold hearted. And her saying like, oh, the thing that she was most frightened of is that she didn't really feel anything. It broke my heart.
Yeah.
I thought Dario, you know, I like their relationship. I like that she finds someone else that she can be with that's not like. Mm-hmm. For the purposes of, you know, alliances, but now she just kind of threw that aside.
Yeah, I think we've all been there. You know, we've all been broken up with or broken up with people. It just kind of happens with the situation. What you see here in the show, she's doing it. What she says to Tyrion is very telling when she says she didn't feel anything when she did it. And that's so powerful. It's because her ambition to achieve what she believes she's been destined to achieve overrides anything personal. I think she had to explore that because she's been growing too. She's been transitioning too, embracing her power, getting stronger, going through what she's gone through. And I think shedding Dario is the last of it. Is the last of her of this whole idea of love and whatever derailing her from where she needs to go, and it was a powerful move, you know. And it's interesting to see that on the show, so because people really love her, but this is a very powerful move. The Tyrion stuff. What did you think about this?
I'm with you. I loved seeing that moment. I will be sad to not gaze upon Dario's beautiful face. I wonder if it is that she's really dead inside or if this wasn't love and this was just a lust kind of thing. And maybe when Ser Jorah eventually returns. I mean, that's what I hope for. I'd love to see them get together.
You think Jorah and you want to see that?
I don't think he really has a shot, but I would love to see that.
He's like her dad. What are you not?
No, when he comes back, he's going to be like grayscale.
No, he's got to find the cure. That's
no, Oh, no, he's going to find the cure just like Shireen did.
Yeah.
But his half his face is going to be like all
love is
yeah.
blind,
gray
Dennis.
And his
love
hair is going to be gray, too.
Yeah.
Right?
He's incestuous, old man.
I would like to see that happen. I don't think it will, but I do love him. It is a scary thing
anyone
to ever say.
Anyone over 50, Avital will definitely consider dating
anyone. Why is there anyone over 50? He's a very handsome man. Your wife will agree with me. She's a friend of mine. Yeah, he's a sexy guy. What's wrong with you?
All right, fair.
I think Perry, he's a sexy man, too. I'll thank put you. It out there. I think. I'm on TV.
He's handsome, but I haven't done this shipping quite like you have.
The shipping?
Shipping.
Relationship.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I've never heard that term, really.
What?
No.
Yes,
no
the best meme was about at a picture of this is from last week's episode. Danny and Yara next day.
Oh, yeah.
Said, the only ship I want to see is this one.
That's pretty good.
I love Tyrion's line. Yes, they used it in the preview, but it worked really well when you saw it in the show. You're in the great game now, and the great game is terrifying. And that's,
One more thing. Sorry, just you were saying she's kind of the opposite of Jon Snow in that regard, but also it brings to mind Robb Stark. Mm. And what was his undoing was this marriage for love. And we can see that won't be her undoing.
Yeah, she doesn't even have a person that she wants to marry. She's just keeping it open. And
who's the best choice?
And Tyrion says, you know, the self-sacrifice is something of a good ruler. Yeah. And that's something. I do believe they were in love and she loved him.
Yeah,
definitely. And broke my heart.
Sometimes ambition has to override because you have someplace to go. It's unfortunate. It's not necessarily true that she didn't love him, and I don't think she was dead inside. I just think it's a matter of there's a bigger goal to achieve for her life.
But if there
and
is
he doesn't fit.
Real love there,
politically,
there would be a sense of loss, even if she did it anyway and knew that this is what had to be done. For her to feel nothing, to me, suggests
I look at her and I think it's pure. I think she genuinely loves the good of the people more so than she does having someone in her life like that. And I mean, it just goes to show that she is probably the best ruler in this scenario, because whether it's someone like Robb Stark who screws up because he falls in love and ruins everything that way, it's someone with ulterior motives that always fails. Mm-hmm. I mean, the High Sparrow had his thing going on, but he was also clearly super manipulative. Cersei has her children and Jaime that always clouds her vision. Yeah. I mean, every single time someone is trying to achieve power and get to the throne and thinks of something else, that's when they tank.
Bravery and strength are doing the right thing, the thing that you know needs to be done in spite of what you feel. And the thing that was confusing was that she said she didn't feel anything. So it wasn't she had to overcome it.
But sometimes people say that, and it's buried deep down. Sometimes the people that you meet are like very, very cold.
Yeah.
They actually have a lot of, you know, passion and love. They just suppress it.
Are you trying to tell us about you, Dennis?
No,
me.
I definitely
Dennis lets it out when he wants to let it out. Don't let him fool you.
I definitely read that as not that she's dead inside, that I didn't feel anything because I have this that I feel so much for.
Because that's so much more important to her.
Well, I mean, we may see, I mean, who knows? She may be breaking down 3 days later on the ship in some random moment because she sees something that reminds him of Dario. And,
it's going to be 3 days later on the ship. Maybe like after she's conquered Westeros, she's married to someone else. Maybe that's when she'll think about it.
Right.
Well, how far are they? Like, where are they on the map right now? Because I got very confused at the end when Varys popped up on the ship. So does that mean they're
Varys
passing
is in
Dorne, puts the if they picked him up along the way, they're pretty damn close already.
Yeah.
Unless he got all
seven.
The way back there. Just
they picked his ass up.
Yeah. he ain't gonna do all that.
But
one more thing, real quick. It's just to finish up the whole thing of undercutting the dogma of religion. You see Tyrion say, "People have told me to believe in this and believe in that and believe in this and believe in the gods and all." And it's always, and I've seen what believing in that can do. You, I believe in, and I think that was the whole point of this. What they were doing, we're talking about. You can believe in anything you want to believe, but believing in people is probably the most purest thing you can do. And I think that was so powerful to have that moment between them. It really solidified their relationship. And in a series, in a show full of people betraying each other, backstabbing each other, and pushing kids out of windows, it's really nice to see like real relationships. And we didn't touch on Bronn and Jaime. That's an awesome relationship. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that he keeps calling him out about how good looking he is. It's very relatable to what you know, when you live nowadays. Like these are relatable things, and you really enjoy those little moments of humanity that break through the darkness.
A big part of the reason we need their friendship.
Yeah.
We need Sam and Gilly. We need some of that pure levity and that honest affection and friendship and dedication to people.
Yeah. Well,
with what you're saying about Tyrion, though,
yeah.
When he kneels down after getting the hand of the queen, the reason why that hit me so much was because I think that's the first time in his life where he knelt and actually meant it.
Yep.
Because all, you know, it's all pomp and circumstance, right? Like in this Westeros, you have to kneel before whatever. Yeah. This is something he actually believed in.
Yeah. Well, we get to that last shot, the ship's going and the dragons flying through. Can we talk about predictions for season 7? What do you think will happen? Do you think we'll get it all wrapped up in a nice, tidy little bow, or what do we think?
I mean, there's supposed to be season 7 and 8. I
mean, what? There's supposed to be an 8?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. There's supposed to be 7 episodes next season.
Don't you read the books?
Yeah.
Well, if the books, I don't think they've gone past.
YouTube's gonna kill me now.
No. But there's supposed to be 7 episodes next season and 6 episodes in the final season. I don't think this is officially confirmed, but this is something I think the showrunners, that's what they want to do, and okay. I'm pretty sure HBO is probably gonna listen to them.
Okay. All right. Well, what do you think is going to happen in season 7?
I mean, I had predicted that we were either going to see at the end of this season Daenerys and her army either leaving on the ships, which we did, or she was going to step foot in Westeros. Right. So I think we'll see the fight for Westeros before we see eventually, I think in season 8. Mm-hmm. I know this is far ahead. That will be the season against the White Walkers.
Yeah.
Where 7 is going to be more about a fight over Westeros.
Right.
Fair. I'm with you in terms of that. This ending, though, was one of the best season endings I think I've ever seen, just because of the fact that, you know, with everything that has gone on with so many of these different people, it kind of like went down the line. It's like Unsullied, like Dany and her team, the dragons, they were all
Dothraki.
Together, and Dothraki too. They were all together, and it felt so good. It feels so good to have a season wrap up with a positive vibe instead of like, oh, someone's on the brink of death, cliffhanger, wait X amount of months until the next time. Something about that, like this type of ending, makes me so excited to think that I have all this time now to like get my hopes up for all these great things to come.
Are you listening to Walking Dead? Are you listening?
I swear that wasn't a jab at Walking Dead.
I will use it as a jab, Avatar.
I'm very curious. It's, I think, a testament to the show that I can say I'm almost nervous about when they finally face off with the White Walkers, because so much is the relationships and the power struggle is so interesting. So when it's just sort of everybody's unified, it'll be interesting. But I there's a part of me that could, I mean, I could just keep watching what we've seen.
Yeah.
And I also wonder, I'm guessing something has to happen to Dany's dragons, because if they face off with the White Walkers and it's just 3 dragons flying overhead, breathing fire on them, and then they win, that seems a little too easy. Although, you know, Jon Snow had a giant and that didn't mean that they won easily. So who knows? But I think something bad is in store for at least one of those dragons.
Everything has a weakness.
And I would like to see. Sorry, last thing.
Okay,
I would like to see. I would like to see Dany knock down a few pegs. Like I feel like she's very good at standing like a queen, and she obviously has the best of intentions, but is a little bit high on herself. And it would be. I think it's important for her as a leader to recognize that she's more vulnerable than she realizes. And yeah, I mean, maybe she does because she has Tyrion by her side. Yeah. But anyway.
But neither one of them have real combat strategy experience.
It's
you know, like yeah, at least Dario had some of that. You know,
well, Tyrion the Blackwater, he had his.
Yeah,
own, so.
But even still, remember what happens with him in Meereen.
Yeah.
He has to defer to Grey Worm. I guess Grey Worm has that experience.
Yeah.
As long as she
and
leans on the right people, I guess.
Yeah. And if the Army of the North comes in, you have Wildlings and Dothraki. It's going to be interesting bedfellows.
Yeah, if they didn't like the Wildlings coming in, what are they thinking about the Dothraki setting up shop?
You say Grey Worm, and now all I can hear is Leslie Jones.
What do you think, Jonathan? Any predictions for next season?
Well, last week I said I'd be very happy if I saw that Arya was in Westeros, and the scene ended with
her in Westeros.
Well, her and Westeros and Daenerys on a ship.
Yeah.
And we got to see that, so that's cool. Yeah, I mean, obviously, now the war of the unification of the Seven is coming.
Yeah.
And that's going to be great. And I do think then the White Walkers would be the end game, because you're not going to have the White Walkers in Season 7, the Great War, and then what do you... All of 8 is just the mop-up, you know?
Right.
So it has to build up to that.
Yeah.
I'm really excited... Just something I was thinking about as far as Jaime, and it was touched, I think Avital mentioned a little bit too on it, is just you think about him from season 1 and you hated him, but we've seen these stabs at his ego, where they always call him a Kingslayer. He's not an honorable man, and you start to see, like, man, he did this to save the people from being burned by wildfire, only to come back and see that Cersei burned the people with wildfire.
That's a great point,
and
Jonathan.
You see his, like, this humanity coming back to him whenever you see him and Brienne, and it's just, it's like, where are we going to see his character now? Is he going to take back his humanity now that all of his children are gone? This woman has, like, manipulated him to no end.
Yeah, even Walder got a shot in when he said, "Yeah, the last time you were in a battle, you got captured."
And you Edmure, he grimaced. You know, it's like, so I'm really curious just to see that. I know it's not battles and action and stuff, but just as far as character development, it's just I just hated Jaime for so long, and I don't anymore. Yeah.
No, he's fantastic.
Are we going to see Arya reunite with Sansa and Jon Snow, or is she going to follow the path of trying to assassinate all the people on her list first?
I don't think they have to be exclusive. Okay. I think she will reunite, and I think she will still have her
own. What's the first thing she's going to do? I think she's going to go on that list. I don't think reuniting
with her... I
think
when she gets news that they're at Winterfell, though, she's going to be real curious to see
that. But who she's going to assassinate there?
Well, she stared at Jaime for a long time when she was there, when they were there at the Twins.
Who's left on her list? I have to think about
Girl needs a hug. I hope she finds her family
first. Cersei's on her list.
Cersei's on the list. Well, see, and that's the thing. My prediction is that we will see Cersei really... what we saw from Cersei in the previous six seasons will pale in comparison to the villain she will be in season seven.
She has the throne.
Yeah, she has the throne. She has all the power. She has the army. She has the mountain. Almost unbeatable. And Jaime, I mean, the prophecy is that the younger sibling will kill her. Possibly Jaime will do that. Possibly it'll be Jaime, or it could be Cersei. And it could be the way Jaime is redeemed and off of Cersei's list, like Steve... Steve Buscemi crossed off Adam Sandler in that movie. Like, it could be that happening there, where Jaime kills Cersei and it takes him off Arya's list.
You think it's the Hound is still on there when she realizes he's alive?
No, she removed him.
Yeah, she removed him because of how he saved her last season, and they had the fight with Brienne, which is fantastic. We didn't see the Hound and Beric and all them in this episode
either.
So
we'll have to catch up with them.
We'll have to do the Brotherhood without banners. All right. I think we've fleshed this thing out. We've cooked it and eaten it. It was such a fantastic... episode. I enjoyed the heck out of it, and I enjoyed the season, and I really want to thank everybody for letting me come on a little bit under halfway through the season and host the show. It's been such a blast to be with you guys and talk about the show. Thank you, Dennis, specifically, very much so. And so let's go around the table and introduce where everybody, or let people know where they can find you. Dennis?
You guys can find me on Twitter at ThinkHero, Instagram Dennis.TZNG. You can find me on Movie Talk Mondays and Fridays. I'll be on some spoiler reviews. The one thing I want to say before we sign off here is, like, you know, we're interested in maybe doing some more Game of Thrones content. Let us know in the comment section if you are interested. Do you want us to do maybe some retro reviews of the old season? Maybe we start with season one, we start with those and talk about them from the perspective of now. If you're interested in that, put in the comments. Or if we just maybe come out with videos once in a while talking about possible theories, predictions, etc., etc., let us know in the comment section below.
Well, first, thank you again for having me on, Dennis, and for making all this happen. And I stand by the fact that I think people should be able to talk freely about the show without having read the books. But for all of you kind commenters who have very positively encouraged us to study up and look at things, because, like, we're all human, we get things wrong, but there's fair space to actually give a nudge. Mm-hmm. I want to say that this experience doing this panel has been so enriching, and I enjoy the show that much more that I have done some research and studied up. So for all of you who have done that in a positive respect,
thank you.
It is greatly appreciated. But now that this is over, you can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemroff every Tuesday on Collider Nightmares and every Saturday on Best of the Week.
I just want to thank Frank back there, who's been switching.
Frank.
Yeah, thanks a lot for Frank giving up his Sundays coming in here.
Thank you, Frank.
Before, we used to shoot this thing with one camera, and he's coming in every week.
And one microphone. It was really weird. We were passing it all around. I want to echo Perry's comments very much, so thank you guys for the constructive criticism, me walking in, especially not understanding the storm I was walking into. It was even more worse than Walking the Walking Dead. So I had, you know, constructively you guys motivated me to step up to the plate, and I appreciate that so much. Avital?
Well, thank you so much for having me on. It's been so fun. You're a great host.
Oh,
it's really nice getting everybody's opinions. It's nice when we agree. It's maybe even nicer when we don't. yeah, this has been really fun, and what a great season. And similarly, it just makes me want to go back and rewatch all of it and read the books. It's so rich when you watch that clip of Melisandre and Arya meeting in the past and how prophetic everything that Melisandre says is. It just makes you go like, this show really has so much texture. And anyway, it's exciting, and I want to go back and look at it. But you can find me at Avital Ash, Twitter, Instagram. And if you feel like it, check out 7p10e.com. That's 7p is in Pacific, 10e is in Eastern.com.
Yeah. YouTube.
/ I think Real Avital Ash.
She's the worst PR person for herself. She does great stuff. She does so many great stuff.
But anyway,
all right. And to our far right, Mr. Jonathan.
Yeah. Again, just to echo these, it's a very echoey room. I want to thank Dennis for the opportunity to be on this show, which I really loved and loved being on with you guys. And thank you to the fans for, you know, some of you tolerating me. I mean, I'm usually a behind-the-scenes guy, post-production and production. So it was nice to have this chance to be up here and give my thoughts on a show that I'm very passionate about. But until then, you could find me working on my maestership at Sonic if you wanted on Instagram and Twitter.
Awesome. Jonathan, great words. Echo them as well. Guys, thanks so much for giving us a chance to come into your homes every Sunday and talk to you about our opinions on the show. We had such a blast going through everything, exploring stuff. Yes, occasionally making mistakes, but also really not making a lot of mistakes. Also, you know, exploring prophecies and what have you, and going knee deep into this stuff because there's so much. It's such a rich a show, as Avital said, and it's been a blast to talk about it with all of you. I've had so much fun, and there's not a day that this is not in my head. This show and the storylines and what have you, the prep work I do, all that jazz, it's so fascinating, so interesting. It is quickly becoming one of my favorite shows to have ever been on television, and I've lived a long, long life.
Yes,
so,
yes.
As Dennis knows.
Yeah, Civil War, right?
Yeah, Civil War.
You fought the Civil War?
I remember those days.
Do you have that Melisandre necklace? Or?
Yeah. Oh, my God, don't make me take it off. I look like George Burns. All right, so I want to thank you guys so much for letting us again. Please, you can follow me at The Roka Says on Twitter and on Instagram. Two quick announcements. The Top 10 Show, which is a show I host with a friend of mine, stand-up comedian Matt Nost. We are premiering on Collider June 29th. We're doing the top 10 Spielberg films. Trust me, you're going to want to watch this. We break them down. You're going to throw your television out the window. You're also going to love the films that we bring up because there are some omissions and some additions you might not expect, and it's a fun, fun time. I feel like that's what's going to happen. I just have a feeling with the way Matt and I do these things. And the second thing is I've also started a new podcast called The Cinephiles, which I do with a film professor friend of mine who here in Los Angeles, and we take one classic film before the year 2000 and break it down over an hour, talking about the production history, talking about the casting, what was going on at the time, and how that film influenced film as it went forward after the film was released, those kinds of things. So anyway, thanks so much again, everybody, for watching and listening to us and commenting below. We look forward to hopefully coming back for season 7 and progressing forward with
it. Yeah, for sure,
for sure. Thank you. See you guys next season.
Thanks.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.